And it was an interesting time to go through journalism school, because I literally remember sitting in the classroom being shown a video of it was a tablet. And they were like, someday, instead of print newspapers, there's going to be a tablet you can hold and read the news and tap on the picture and you can, you know, and it seemed so far-fetched to us, but.
You guys must have had like some futurist come in or something and talk to you.
I mean, and within literally like a couple of years, 2 years, I think after that, it was almost a reality.
When you're driven, the need to accomplish a goal is relentless. Hard work and ambition compel you to do whatever's necessary. In my work as a personal injury trial lawyer for 18 years, it's common to meet driven people. Those with drive can have different personalities, careers, or backgrounds, but they possess one common factor. Despite their passions, driven people want to surround and motivate themselves with other driven people. If you want to learn how to overcome obstacles by learning from others, then tune in here. This is the Driven Crowd Podcast.
Thank you for tuning into episode 40 of the Driven Crowd Podcast, fueled by Snellings Law. I'm your host, Scott Snellings. Today we have Jamie Heit. Jamie is the brain behind the Facebook group Frisco Residents Who Care, which aims to keep residents of Frisco informed about issues affecting the community. The group currently has over 17,000 members and is growing strong. Jamie is also an alumna of Leadership Frisco, Class 25.
Best class ever.
Absolutely. And has served on the Frisco ISD Long Range Planning Advisory Board, as well as the Frisco Fastpacs Marketing Committee. Jamie, welcome to the Driven Crowd Podcast.
Hey, Scott. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. We had a chance to catch up a little bit beforehand. And as I do with all of our Frisco leadership guests, and we've had several, but especially Class 25, a very special welcome to you today.
Thank you.
All right. So let's get started with kind of your history. How have you gotten from where you started to where you are today?
Yeah. So I moved to Frisco almost 9 years ago from the Washington, D.C., Northern Virginia area. I grew up in Princeton, New Jersey, went to college at the University of Arizona in Tucson.
And like, then you're a Jersey girl?
I'm a Jersey girl, born and raised.
Okay. For some reason, I never knew that. And you certainly don't hear it in your voice.
No, that part of the state, I mean, it's little, it's a little pocket in the middle of the state. You typically don't hear the accent that you hear in North and South Jersey. But yeah, I was born in Princeton.
Okay.
Went kindergarten through 12th grade at the same high school, just 5 miles north of Princeton in a small little farm town called Skillman. And went off to college in Tucson, Arizona, mainly because I wanted to get as far away from from New Jersey as possible at the time.
And somewhere warm.
And my grandparents lived in Tucson. So although my initial destination was West Coast, my mom convinced me to at least go where I had some relatives. So I ended up at the U of A in Tucson, graduated there with a dual degree in journalism and German. Just another interesting little tidbit.
Why German?
So my high school was actually, because it was such a small school district, 7th through 12th grade.
Okay.
So starting in 7th grade, we had the option to take a foreign language. And my dad's family is Jewish. My mom's family is not. And his parents, my grandparents, used to speak Yiddish in front of us when we'd see them. And of course, it drove me crazy because I didn't understand it. And my older brother was studying Spanish, so I didn't want to study Spanish. So I picked German, mainly thinking if I learned German, maybe I can pick up some of what my grandparents were saying. So I started studying German in 7th grade and did it all through high school. Ended up over in Germany in 1990, right after the Berlin Wall came down.
Oh, wow.
I went as an exchange student. It was a great, I mean, amazing point in history and very fortunate to be there at the time. So climbed right through the Berlin Wall, was in Berlin the night Germany won the World Cup in 1990.
That wasn't crazy at all, I'm sure.
Not at all. And when you're 15 and in Germany and no parents, it was fun. So that was kind of how I started studying German, and no intention of ever majoring in it, but got to college and tested out of so much of it. It was kind of a no-brainer to just go ahead and double major. I have not used it much since graduation, so other than a few trips abroad. And Yeah. So I graduated college and moved to the Washington, D.C. area for a career in public relations,
okay,
media relations, which is how I ended up meeting my husband. Well, we met actually at Georgetown University. I played college soccer, and so did he for Emory. And when I first moved to D.C. for work, I was just looking for a place to go play and ended up out on a field on a men's team. Me and 21 guys and my
you
husband.
You had your pick.
I did have my pick. My husband was just starting law school at the time at American. He was on the team. So that's how I met my husband. Yeah. And we ended up staying in that area for 17 years while he, of course, did his career in law, had three kids. And I'd stepped away from my career to be a full-time stay-at-home mom.
Okay.
So I had always kind of felt strongly that if one of us, if we had the financial means to do so, I wanted to be a hands-on stay-at-home mom. So I have been doing that. My oldest just turned 20. So 20 years I've been home with three kids and gotten my hands into projects along the way. We moved to Frisco when my youngest was just about to start kindergarten. My oldest was just starting sixth grade middle school. And the Frisco Residents Who Care page wasn't really anything planned. It actually began, you may know this story, but it started over a single issue. The elementary school where my son was going to kindergarten, the city was in the process of trying to rezone land directly across the street to mm-hmm. put in a large, like 11-acre substation to power the Star in Frisco. Oh,
okay, so a huge electricity hub.
Huge, yeah, big electricity substation. Which, of course, had a lot of residents concerned about, A, just safety with children and teachers right across the street and neighboring homes, home values. The original loaning for the zoning for the land was commercial, not for utility. And so our house was right up the street as well. And I'd heard residents didn't know any of this was happening. They felt the city was trying to pull the wool over their eyes and it's just not how I go about things. So I kind of stepped in, I guess, and sat down with, I think we'd lived there 6 months, didn't know who anyone was. I reached out to planning and zoning commissioners, sat down, had coffee with all the city council representatives, met with Encore. I mean, it gathered residents. It was a year-long process, but I kind of realized if residents don't know what's happening right next door to them, maybe there's a way to keep the community informed. And so I, about a year after starting the process, the zoning was denied and the substation ended up in a much more suitable area that already had utility and decided to just change the name of the Facebook group from, I think it was like Frisco Residents Who Against Encore or whatever our issue was, to just a Frisco Residents Who Care. And try to create a platform for the community to share what's happening in the city, trying to get people involved and knowledgeable about municipal elections, charities, you name it. Does anyone have a painter they recommend or
right.
a physician or, you know, just sort of let it holistically evolve into what it is today.
Okay, awesome. Yeah. Well, I'm going to take you back to where you first started. So growing up in New Jersey, you wanted to get out to the West Coast. Mom convinced you to go to Arizona. Where does that independent streak come from?
Mm, that's a good question. I think I was born with that.
Okay.
I'm a middle child, two brothers. So
you were the forgotten child. That's what my middle child says.
I don't know if I was forgotten. I think it'd be hard to forget me. I just probably inherited it from both sides of the family. I sort of got the independent, stubborn, outspoken gene, I guess.
Okay.
But yeah, and growing up with brothers and the small the neighborhood I grew up in at the time just happened to have all boys in the neighborhood. So I was always out playing baseball, soccer, riding bikes with all the kids in the neighborhood who at the time, 95% of them were boys. So
gotcha.
I was always, I guess, wanting to kind of fit in and just being outgoing. And probably a little stubborn, wanting to kind of fit in with my older brother's friends and not let them boss me around too much. So that's probably where it came from. And also, I think growing up in a small community, I graduated with 92 students. It's a great place to grow up. It was a phenomenal school district, but you feel like everybody knows everybody. I mean, you know, you have the same teachers your brother had the year before. I was ready for just a complete change of scenery.
So lots of schools on the East Coast. Why did you want to go so far away?
Oh, okay. So this story goes back to high school. I mentioned I was very athletic. I was a soccer player. I also ran track. In my sophomore year of high school, so I had qualified for states for track, I started having back pain. Started running the intermediate hurdles, thought I had just pulled a muscle in my back. Got to a point I literally couldn't tie my shoes before my races. Ooh. We'd hit a bump in the car and I'd be in absolute pain. So I went into the orthopedic doctor, found out I had what's called spondylolisthesis. I had a grade 4. It was very significant injury to my lower back. Was told I probably shouldn't be able to walk. Yet I was running track races, playing soccer games, being recruited for college soccer, and tried as best I could to avoid back surgery. But by my senior year, I had 8 hours of back surgery. Oof. So at the time in high school, when most students are looking ahead to their college careers and where they want to go, I was literally in the hospital for a week, had my back fused with bone from my hip, and was told I may never run. Which was very depressing to me at the time. I mean, as an athlete, you probably get, you lose sort of a piece of your identity. So my stubbornness, honestly, I knew at that point, well, there goes my hope of playing collegiate soccer. And just kind of wanted to just get out, just go far away. So I left New Jersey literally the day after my high school graduation in my car and drove out to Tucson and lived in an apartment. And that was how I ended up in Tucson. And I ironically ended up a year later playing soccer. So it didn't hold me back. It just, I needed time to kind of recover from surgery.
Wow. So you mentioned something interesting there, how I guess you had always grown up identifying as an athlete?
Yes. Yeah, I just, from a young age, I did gymnastics when I was a little kid. Mm-hmm. I was just always active, always into every sport. I mean, I ran cross country and track and played basketball, soccer. So I had always, that had always been a part of my identity.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, when you're faced with suddenly having something, you know, that you love, that's sort of an outlet for you. I used to go for late night runs as a way to kind of manage stress. And and all of a sudden you're faced, A, with chronic pain and an you know, you don't know what your future is going to look like. Like, will I be able to run? Will I be able to work out? Will I be able to, you know, have children and carry a pregnancy? Will I be in chronic pain? If all those things, you just... It's a lot to take in.
Yeah, so. Especially as a 18-year-old, 17-year-old?
17, yeah.
Man.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I think that identity thing is something that, you know, isn't just limited to kids, obviously. I mean, how many lawyers do you know, right? Your husband's a lawyer.
Yep.
Who, like, that's their identity. And right. If something were ever to happen, if they were to have a stroke or, you know, have their bar license taken away from them for something.
Yeah.
I think that's one of the biggest things that people struggle with is when their identity is taken or challenged.
Yeah.
Right? Because then all of a sudden it's like, okay, I've built my whole persona on this one thing. You know, Scott is a lawyer. That's how I identify. That's how I, you know, think of myself. And then if that's taken away, it's all of a sudden this big, okay, well, wow, well, actually, who am I?
Yes.
Did you have to struggle with any of those things at that age?
Definitely. Because at that age, I mean, you know, though I was a good student as well, and I had academic endeavors, right, not just athletic. But yeah, you have sort of an image in your own mind of what you've been since, gosh, as long as I can remember, I was involved in athletics. So to suddenly be faced with, you know, the reality that I may not be able to do this, it's depressing, honestly. It's tough to face. And not to get too deep, I don't want to say everything happens for a reason, but an interesting story is that I met my husband, I mentioned playing soccer in DC. We met on a soccer field. We were both former college soccer players. And his dad, my father-in-law, was a gastroenterologist. And he actually was a former football player for Pitt in the 60s.
Okay.
When my husband was about 12 years old, my father-in-law was involved in an automobile accident, which minor to the extent he walked away from it, seemingly uninjured, but it triggered this severe torticollis, like neurological condition, where he was bound to a wheelchair, could not shave, could not control his muscles.
As a
doctor and a surgeon, he went through, I mean, you talk about, it makes my issue seem almost minimal, but he couldn't practice anymore. I mean, he had a family to take care of, and this was way before I entered the picture, but he has always kind of been a little bit of someone I guess I've looked up to, because I've learned that he reinvented himself, really. He took, you know, that identity of I was an athlete, I'm a gastroenterologist who, you know, has a practice and treats patients. I now can't practice that. And he was in so much chronic pain that he became one of the leading chronic pain management and addiction doctors. And this was back in probably the, I don't know, 80s, early 80s. Let's see. Yeah, probably mid 80s.
Okay.
And has since stopped practicing, but had a successful practice, still, you know, works publishing and works with the FDA and on certain court cases, and very, very involved in pain management and addiction. But it was just fascinating to me that of all the people I could have met in Washington, D.C., I meet my husband, and his father had been through something that very few people, I think, can relate to.
Absolutely. So, and wow, what a testament to his mindset, right? Because,
yeah.
I mean, how many people would have just thrown their hands up in the air and said, okay, my life's essentially over. I'll do the day to day, but I'm certainly not going to, you know, go find and reinvent myself and you know, create a career that I can thrive in.
Exactly.
That's amazing. Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. So how did you get back into soccer? If all of a sudden, you know, you're barely able to walk, I would imagine, after the surgery, how do you eventually get back to play not just soccer, but collegiate soccer, which that's rough.
I know. I guess it was determination, really. And granted, just not to age myself, but my surgery was in 1993. That was the year I graduated high school. And, you know, the medical field is obviously much further along now. But, you know, I had an 8-hour back surgery. No physical therapy. Wasn't a thing back then.
What is physical therapy in the
80s? They put me in a brace and said, you know, good luck. So I actually, during my recovery, I had my mom drive me to a YMCA nearby, and I'd get in the pool and just do my own therapy. I'd walk just against the water to build muscle strength, to the point, eventually it took a while, I was able to swim, I was walking, went off to college and went skydiving about 9 months after back surgery, which I probably shouldn't have done. But
I would say that would probably be on the
probably
do not do
the
list.
Best, but I called my mom after. At least I didn't tell her beforehand, so she wasn't too worried. But
it's the key with moms. You gotta always tell them after you've done it.
Guess what I did today? Not, you know. And eventually I just started getting out with friends, kicking the ball, finding a city league to just work on my touch. Obviously I was able to run, so I would get myself in shape. And when you really love something, I guess you find a way to make it work. So that was sort of how I got back to it. I just took a little time to recovery and jumped in.
And so you were a walk-on, I'm assuming, in Arizona, yeah?
Yes. And well, back then too, this was before a lot of schools had D1 teams for women.
Right.
So Title IX changed that. So I was in Arizona 93 through 97 We didn't get our official D1 team for women's soccer till 96.
Okay.
So it was a competitive club, which is how a lot of the campuses were.
Right.
Arizona State. I mean, just a lot of schools didn't have as many female sports teams. So it was a lot of club and travel.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. And so you said you graduated with a double major in German. And what was the other one?
Journalism.
Journalism. Okay. Mm-hmm. Why journalism?
Yeah. So I probably, like a lot of students, went off to college with an idea of what I thought I wanted to do. Thought I wanted to major in political science and maybe go to law school. And I took one poli-sci class and was bored out of my mind and said, yeah, I can't do this for 4 years. And so I started thinking about what are some things I like to do. And I've always liked writing. So I took a journalism class, just filled an elective and enjoyed it and thought, you know, I could probably do this for 4 years. It was also at a large campus, a smaller department. So I liked the fact that the class sizes were smaller. The curriculum was interesting. And again, this was at a time, this was pre-internet. So
yeah.
This was like print journalism. And it was an interesting time to go through journalism school because I literally remember sitting in the classroom being shown a video of it was a tablet. And they were like, someday instead of print newspapers, there's going to be a tablet you can hold and read the news and tap on the picture and you can, you know, and it seemed so far-fetched to us, but.
Yeah, you must have had like some futurist come in or something and talk to you.
I mean, and within literally like a couple of years, 2 years, I think after that, it was almost a reality. So throughout the course of my journalism school, we sort of saw the world of journalism begin to change. Not quite to what it is today, but we went from learning how to, you know, set the newspaper, print the paper. In fact, one of my classes, we produced the newspaper for Tombstone. So we had an apartment for students. We'd go down to Tombstone, two students at a time, find news stories in the city, go out, find sources, interview, write on deadline, bring it back to campus, design the paper, print it, and then bring the papers to the residents of Tombstone.
That's pretty cool.
Which was pretty cool. And then it was literally not until after I graduated that the internet kind of became a thing.
And completely turned everything on its head.
Yeah. Yeah. Some ways for good and some ways not.
Right, right. Okay, so I guess let's jump into Frisco Residents Who Care. You gave us the background on it.
Yep.
Did your journalism background have any effect on your ability to get this thing going?
Yes and no. I think with the original issue that I was dealing with at the time with the substation, you know, my purpose in that wasn't to point fingers at the city or anyone that they've done something wrong. It was really just to question, with all the land we had in the area, why rezone a parcel of land from commercial to utility?
Which sounds like a journalistic story.
Right. And so, and there was another piece of land literally on the other side of Beavers Bend Park. So it's from one side of the park to the other where there already was utility. So yeah. I just questioned, and the way I spread information, the way my mind worked was to use my PR and journalism background. So, residents already were hearing about it and were up in arms. And I kind of stepped in more to just sort of help lead the process. But I did, I issued press releases and I guess my instinct kicked in. So I used a lot of my journalism background for that issue. And then once Frisco Residents Who Care became Frisco Residents Who Care, I just sort of let it evolve. Word of mouth, you know, they always say is the best form of marketing is word of mouth.
Right, yeah.
So it started obviously very small and I have to look, but I'm probably pushing about 18,000 members now. You know, and as it grows, the page has changed a little bit. But I think overall it serves a purpose in the community. So as long as it continues to do that, and it continues to help the community and not hurt the community, I've sort of told myself I'll continue to volunteer and keep it going. But It is a job.
Yeah. Yeah. I would imagine so with 18,000 people. Yeah. And you know, you can't just let everybody post anything they want to. Yep. Somebody has to read them all and somebody has to make sure that they are following the policies and the rules. So what advice would you give to somebody who, say, they want to start something similar, or they want to start some sort of a Facebook group or some sort of an online targeted group around a specific issue or community? What kind of advice would you give them to get it started?
I guess, I don't know. I mean, the way I've gone about it is to sort of just be open-minded to the potential for that. You may start out with an initial idea of what that's going to look like, but you have to be open-minded to what the members who join the group. I mean, at least for me, I created the page not for myself or for a specific intention, but I really created it as a platform for Frisco residents. So, you know, trying to keep it on target with why you've started it, but yet still be open to the idea that that may evolve or change. So, yeah, that'd probably be one.
And so how do you keep it growing and healthy? How do you encourage people to post or encourage engagement?
Yeah.
Or do you?
Now I really don't have to encourage people to. It's probably the flip side. There's almost such a level of involvement. You don't want it to become such a busy page that people tune out. Because sometimes when you get too many posts coming, you just lose track and,
right. You
know, it sort of becomes too much noise. So early on, there was encouragement. I mean, I would share posts and there was a lot of discussion and dialogue. There's certain times of the year that the page gets a little more heated. It's usually
election times.
Election season, which at least on a local level seems to be every other, I don't know, few months, it seems.
Yeah, exactly.
But so I'm currently now not having to encourage people to post. It's really the opposite. I'm getting so many posts a day that I have to filter through and approve or not approve. So it's filtering out the stuff that you think is actually beneficial to the entire community versus just to like that one person who wants to post. The trick too now is there's so many bots. There are so many, you know, so you can create page rules and people will agree to them, join the page, and then immediately break the rules. So it's been a learning curve for me to try to figure out, you know, is it a real person? Are they just using the page to advertise their own business? It's a little tricky.
Wow.
So
what are kind of the most difficult parts of it for you?
Yeah, the difficult parts, aside from just, I mean, I don't allow advertising on the page. And that's difficult for me as someone with a marketing background because I understand the need to want to share your business. Obviously, we want local business owners to be successful. And there is one thread where I allow people to post their business. So it's not that it's not allowed anywhere on the page. It's just keeping it in that one spot.
Right.
Almost, I wish Facebook had the capability to sort of have tabs, you know.
Or channels.
More like a website as opposed to a Facebook group. But so that's one. The other is always, of course, you know, sometimes people want to bring awareness or submit a post about something that I may personally not agree with. But that doesn't mean that there's no validity in it.
Yeah.
So that's probably, I'd say, what takes the most sort of patience is to learn to understand that it's not just my page and my voice. So allowing other people to use it for things that they are passionate about as well.
How much time are you having to spend on this on a weekly basis?
I don't track my time like an attorney-ish does.
Well, I don't either.
Oh my gosh.
I don't either. I don't have to do that. No.
Yeah, that's tough because it's gotten, I mean, I've done it now for probably 7 years. It's almost part of my daily routine to just like when everyone picks up their phone and checks their emails or texts, I look at Facebook and look at what's sitting in my pending post approval or membership approval. I mean, multiple times throughout the day. And sometimes it's late at night. Sometimes you get, you know, depending on what's happening, you get messages. And I always feel responsible that I should respond to them and not leave people hanging. So it's a lot of time, honestly.
Is it just you?
It's primarily just me. It was just me for years. And then back in like 2020, 2021, I added Sadaf Haq as a co-admin. But if you know Sadaf, she's involved in so many organizations in Frisco. And again, this is just a volunteer, it's just a Facebook group. Yeah. So I have to try to remind myself, you know, it's at the end of the day, it's just a Facebook group. It's not worth, you know, getting stressed. And that's why I can't stand seeing people argue and be mean to each other or, you know, putting each other down and starting, you know, sort of keyboard warrior mentality. Because at the end of the day, in the grand scheme of life, like, it's just Facebook. So
have you been approached by advertisers to, you know,
I have,
I guess, somehow monetize the page?
Yeah, a few years ago, probably pre-COVID, I was approached. But again, at the time, I'm like, it's just I'm not doing it as a source of money.
Right.
I'm really doing it for the community. So I feel like once you sort of invite advertisers in, you know.
And you become that much more responsible.
That much more responsible. And, you know, I just don't want to feel beholden to anybody or have rules that I need to, I don't know. I just have let it kind of just be what it is. And as long as I have time to continue to admin and approve posts and, you know, it gets a little harder as the group gets bigger. I used to, when it first started, I literally would read every comment and like every comment to show that I had read it. 18,000 members.
Or delete that comment.
Or delete it. it's too much. So like, I have a life outside of Facebook. You get people who I think just assume that someone is nonstop 24/7 following every word on the group, and it's just not a reality. So I check in when I can, and it's usually multiple times throughout the day. And Sadaf's there, like if my family goes on vacation or if I'm somewhere where there's bad Wi-Fi, you know, I can say, hey, keep a closer eye on the group, and she'll do that for me. So,
it's not like the group just works during business hours or just during the week. So this is a 7 day a week thing for you.
Yeah. 7 day a week, 24/7. Cause you get people who, you know, maybe they're up late at night and that's what their time to catch up on what's happening in the world of social media or news or whatever. So they'll submit posts. And obviously, I mean, no one expects me to immediately respond to everything.
Right.
But there are times where, yeah, you may, and then you get messages, you know, because person A and person B are yelling at each other on the group. And that's not what I want in my group. So I try to, and I think I've done a good job of establishing pretty early on that that's not really acceptable on Frisco Residents Who Care. So.
Sure. But you have new people every day.
Yeah, you do.
So what has been like a surprising positive benefit from running this group?
So, yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I don't want to say I didn't take it seriously, but I'm surprised how valuable the group is to so many people in the community, including like people I've never met. I mean, I could be out with my kids at a restaurant or a grocery store, and literally the cashier at the grocery store will say, "Are you from Frisco Residents Who Care?" So it's interesting the recognition I get in the community from people I don't know who are fans of the group, or they find the group very helpful for them. So I just never realized the impact, I guess, that it would have for so many people in the community.
And I mean, it's the reason that you were in Leadership Frisco, right?
It is. I mean, you know, once I started Frisco Residents Who Care, and after my issue with the substation was resolved, I realized the impact that one person can have in a community. Mm. And just by paying attention and, you know, prior to moving to Frisco, I didn't pay attention to local municipal elections. If you ask me who my city council members were or my school board trustees, I had no idea. So I realized the value and the importance of just being aware of what's happening and the difference that being an informed, engaged resident has. So I just kind of decided to help others, I think, recognize the same. And I started volunteering with specifically at the time, a lot of school district committees. So, which I'm still currently doing. I was on long range planning. I've been on the facilities and evaluations committee. I was just on the calendar committee, which we plan the calendar for next school year, which is a very interesting process to go through because school calendars, you'll never please everybody. getting ready for what will a capital improvements committee, which will become a bond, the school district bond steering committee in the fall. So
yeah, we having kids in two different school districts, we always pay attention to the calendars to see where they differ between the two. If they was just the same, however it came out, we'd be so happy.
I know.
It's never the same,
and
though.
And it has in the last, I think it's the second year now, where at least Frisco ISD, at least spring break and winter break are aligned with neighboring districts.
Yeah.
So, and Collin College for dual credit students. But start dates and end dates still vary a little bit, and just how they do all their little breaks in between. Yeah.
It's funny when you get involved in a community issue, you realize just how important local politics are.
Yeah.
Right. Because those are the people who are probably making most of the decisions that have direct effects on you.
Yeah. They have
not necessarily the national government, not 100%. Necessarily the state government, but mm-hmm. your local politicians are the ones that it's important. Because they can do something that will directly affect you the very next day.
Right. Yeah. And there's such low voter turnout. So mm-hmm. when they literally say one vote, your vote matters. I mean, it sounds cliche and, oh, I'm busy, I won't go vote, it doesn't matter. But I mean, we've had Frisco elections, you know, be determined by mere small numbers of residents who voted or didn't vote.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So I'm always trying to push the get out and vote message. You know, there's only some, it's something I think a lot of people who do realize that sort of pull our hair out. Like, how can people not, it doesn't take long, like go to the polls, you can vote throughout early voting and there's no lines. Just vote, just get out and vote. I don't care who you vote for, but yeah, but you realize with local elections, there's a lot of voter apathy. A lot of people don't turn out and vote. So those that do have that much more power in their votes. So,
absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. When there's a smaller vote count, yours means that much more.
Yeah.
Well, Jamie, thank you so much for being on today.
Thank you.
I always ask everybody for book recommendations. What are your top three books?
My kids are going to laugh at me because I've actually become numb. I don't read for leisure much anymore.
Okay.
But a few of my favorites just over the years, my kids are huge readers, and my husband, but a few of my favorites that I think everyone should read, The Diary of Anne Frank.
Okay. I think we read that in seventh grade, if I'm not mistaken.
I know, and my son is in eighth grade this year, and he's in GT ILA. They read the book Night, and actually they're going to the Holocaust Museum tomorrow for a field trip, which is pretty cool. So I would suggest that. As a kid, I loved the Narnia series.
Yeah, C.S. Lewis.
And then I don't know what my third would be. I'm trying to think. I always liked the classics, growing up, which I find kids in school nowadays, I mean, school, they don't read as many of the classics, The Great Gatsby and mm-hmm. Catcher in the Rye and some of those. So,
all right. Yeah. So any of the classics.
Any of the classics. That's kind of, yeah.
Awesome. Well, Jamie, thank you again. And thank you to everyone for tuning into the Driven Crowd podcast. We will see you next time.